Hello and welcome to Your Voice with Senator John Bonacic. I'm Mark Hansen. Senator Bonacic, it's been an interesting week in Albany. We have a new Senate Majority Leader, and I wanted to get your reaction not only to the selection but also to the process.
Well, first of all, John Flanagan is a friend of mine. I've known him for 25 years. We've served in the Assembly together for 9 years, and we had the vote yesterday. It's a vote in the conference. We have 32 Republicans and one Democrat. Senator Felder sits with us. So technically there's 33 that voted. And it was between Senator Flanagan and Senator DeFrancisco. And it was a very polite, civil discussion with our members, because we respect both these senators. And many of us felt that whoever became Majority Leader, that their values and goals are the same, and they both had leadership qualities to lead the conference. It was a close vote. Senator Flanagan won, and now we move on to do the people's business. I thought Senator Skelos, who addressed the conference before there was any vote, behaved in a very classy manner. He resigned as Majority Leader. He admitted that for him to stay would be a distraction. And he also, which was critically important, said, I will stay in the conference as a senator, because there were newspaper reports that he might resign. And, you know, over the weekend, you don't know what's rumors, what's valid, what's not valid, what he said or didn't say, but we knew he was going to address us at that conference on Monday. And now, as you know, he is facing charges against him, which he maintains he's innocent, but he would no longer be a distraction. And what we felt in the conference is we had to stay united, one voice, and to get on with the people's business. And the missing element now, everything's going to stay in place. By that I mean all of the leadership positions for chairman, all of the staff, no changes. But there will be a vacancy now in the Education Committee chairman. And because Senator Flanagan chaired that. And as he moves up to Majority Leader, he will have to make that appointment shortly. And as you know, it's a very hot topic with a lot of things, issues going on, whether it's the Common Core, it's dealing with regions, Board of Education, the governor's agenda, our agenda on education. So, but I think the conference themselves had many discussions at budget time trying to move away from what the governor was trying to do. So I think we've had two or three conferences just on teacher evaluations and other hot button issues. And I think it's been all aired out with our conference in the direction that we've picked already for the most part. And that is every stakeholder will have an opportunity to deal with the Board of Education, whether they're administrators, teachers, parents, school board members, to say how we think we should proceed when it comes to educating our children and testing. So I think we did the right thing. The governor's not too happy with us because we didn't embrace his policies, and that was a 50% teacher evaluation on test scores. But we didn't think that was fair. You have disabled children, you have special ed children, you have poor districts where you might not get the nurturing at home in education, you had children that didn't attend school, and why should all of those problems or headwinds be put on the backs of teachers in testing? So, as I said, we resisted the governor and we put it, the responsibility where it belongs, in the Board of Education and the Board of Regents. So that's a good thing. When I say now we're getting back to the people's business, Today, I think we have an agenda of 40 to 50 bills that we're going to do through the Senate. There wasn't much of a distraction, and we're moving on. We're united, doing the people's business for our conference, lowering taxes, creating jobs, student excellence, improving quality of life. That's what we stand for, and that's what we'll continue to stand for, regardless of who the majority leader is. You hear that term in baseball, next man up, someone gets injured, next man or woman up. That's our philosophy, because we are united as a conference.
When you mentioned that the Senate has been continuing to focus on the business at hand, one of those important duties that you have as chairman of the Judiciary Committee is making sure that qualified judges are appointed to the Court of Claims that handles civil litigation against the state. And you took action on that recently.
Well, I chair the Senate Judiciary, and the governor gives us nominees. I've had three separate sessions where we have approved 41 judges in the Court of Claims. And the Court of Claims, for our viewers, they may not know what that is. It's judges that sit on prisoner claims that they claim their civil rights were violated. If there's any lawsuits against the state, like highway defects, it's mainly designed in highway negligence cases. When you're a Court of Claim judge, you have no jury trials. You sit there and make the decisions on these cases. But when you have a Court of Claim judge appointed, that doesn't mean he stays as a Court of Claim judge. He could be tapped in Supreme Court or put in other aspects of where the court administration wants to plug him in, her in, either one, depending on caseloads, counties where they're top heavy and other things. So that's how it works, and we may be seeing other judges come before us, whether it's Supreme Court, surrogate court, or county court. So that's ongoing. And we were glad to be able to give more manpower or woman power to judges to start addressing heavy caseloads throughout the state of New York.
When you mentioned woman power, last week the Senate had its annual Women of Distinction ceremony, and you had quite an outstanding honoree that came from your district. Let's talk about her a little bit.
Her name is Dr. Joyce Willits. She is a very learned woman. She had a science major. I think it was applied biology. She's worked in private sector pharmaceutical schools, companies, whether as a director of regulatory policies or toxology. And she's quite traveled throughout the United States, moving around. But she landed in Orange County in my district 20 years ago. And we didn't honor her for her private sector achievements. We honored her for what she gave back to her community. And I don't know if you've captured any of my interview with her, but I don't know what you captured, so why don't I hold it? Because if it shows what she did, I won't have to repeat it.
We did capture some.
Oh, good.
So
good. Okay.
Let's take a look at you speaking with Dr. Willits.
Okay, Mark, thank you.
I know that you're involved with the Seward Historical Restoration. Tell us what you did there.
We William Henry Seward, who was, the 12th governor, I think, of the state.
You're asking me, but I'll say yes.
He's got one of the biggest paintings in the governor's hall that we saw this afternoon, so that was nice to see that. William Henry Seward was born in Florida, New York, where I currently live, and the property had fallen into a real state of disrepair, and so a group of enthusiasts got together, and I came across a grant that I thought we could apply for, so we went ahead and applied for it, and we got $400,000 to help restore the property.
And I know that we've also brought state money to that project.
She had her son up and her best friend, But what wasn't said was that she really connected to the students in the high school. She expanded a science fair where she got increased it by quadruple the amount of students that participate in science projects. She got grants for the school that expanded the cafeteria that had trails, nature trails. She started a local newspaper, a chamber newspaper to keep people informed. She touched so many lives in her community, not only students, but adults. And for that, we felt she should have been a woman of distinction, and she was a terrific ambassador for that role.
You live not very far from the U.S. Military Academy at West Point, and in addition to honoring women of distinction, we had a visit of cadets from West Point come up here recently, and you have an outstanding cadet from your district that came up.
Yes, Cadet Christopher Whipple. He was from Sullivan County, the Neversink area. West Point, we have West Point Day, and it's a day I'm very proud of. I happen to have visited all three of the military institutions in Colorado, in Maryland, and here in Orange County. I have to say, I'm prejudiced, but Orange County, the West Point facility is the most beautiful. And we really tip our hats to the men and women in all three institutions. This is a day where we have the major speak. The superintendent comes up, he addresses the chamber. I think they came up with close to 15 cadets. We have breakfast with them. And these, you have to understand, are young and men and women who might be in a final year, and they may be in Middle East or Afghanistan, in the front lines, protecting our freedoms. And it's always an inspiring day to see the young men and women come up here who exemplify what I consider are the strength of our people and protecting our freedoms.
You got up on the Senate floor to talk about Cadet Whipple. Let's take a look at your remarks.
I have the privilege of living in Orange County, my home, where Senator Larkin is, and where we have the great West Point Academy. I'm really here to recognize all of you. You are our heroes today, and you will always be our heroes in America. But one cadet I would like to introduce from our district, I'd ask him to stand up, Christopher Whipple, Cadet Christopher Whipple. Christopher Whipple is from Sullivan County. He's majoring in human geography and Chinese. And I want to thank you all for the great courage and your willingness to sacrifice everything to protect our country and our freedoms. I always said that the strength of America is our people, and you are the best of the best of the American people.
What pleased me was that this was a bipartisan praise of West Point. People, legislators on both sides of the aisle got up to recognize our heroes and pay respect to all of those cadets at West Point.
Senator Bonacic, that's all the time we have. Thank you for joining us and updating us on what you've been doing here in Albany for your constituents. And thank you for watching. For more information, you can go to Senator Bonacic's website at bonacic.nysenate.gov.